हेलो फ्रेंड्स, इन द सेफ्टी एस्पेक्ट्स वन ऑफ द फिनोमिना इज करोजन विच इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम द एक्सीडेंट्स पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू बिकॉज इन द हिस्ट्री देर वेर मेनी एक्सीडेंट्स ड्यू टू द करोजन स्पेशली व्हेन वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट द बॉयलर्स रिएक्शन वेसल्स प्रेशर वेसल्स एटसेट्रा एंड दैट इज वाई वी मस्ट नो अबाउट द करोजन erosion, their causes, inspection, and how to prevent these corrosion phenomena. So what are the methods available for this prevention of this corrosion phenomena? So let us discuss first what exactly the corrosion is. So it is an electrochemical reaction between the metal and its environment. So generally it is an oxidation process. So when metal is exposed to the atmosphere, then that metallic surface is oxidized with the oxygen which is available in the environment, that is in the air, and metal oxides are prepared. So these metal oxide preparations or the oxidation phenomena is nothing but the corrosion. So it results in loss of metal or weakening of it reaches deeply creates maintenance problems and incurs cost of loss. So corrosion due to oxidation at high temperature is called scaling. So that is the main phenomena. In the previous years, the boiler accidents, boiler explosions is there due to this corrosion or the scaling issues. Then there is another type, that is corrosion pitting. So that may be results due to the difference between the oxygen concentration inside and outside the pit. That is again the another type of corrosion pitting. And some other types of corrosion may be a general corrosion, local corrosion, external corrosion, galvanic corrosion, Kravik corrosion, knife line corrosion, intragranular and stress related corrosion, scaling corrosion, exfoliation corrosion, corrosion pitting, and erosions. So these are some of the corrosion types in the pressure vessels. So we are going to discuss a very few from them. So exfoliation is a type of scaling caused by oxidation in steam exposure. And intergranular corrosion occurs in the stainless steel heated up to 500 to 800 degrees Celsius and then exposed to the corrosive conditions. So intergranular movement changes, molecular changes, structural changes at 500 to 800 degrees Celsius, that corrosion is called as intergranular corrosion. Then there is another type of corrosion, that is galvanic corrosions. So we know that what exactly the galvanic cell is. So if there is a condition due to the current flow between the two dissimilar metals arises, and if the corrosion is occur, then that corrosion is called as galvanic corrosion. And then erosion. So it is a type of corrosion again, and it is caused by flow restrictions or change of directions. So many times we need the pipe fittings like elbows, T's, nozzles, valves, etc., where there is a change in direction. And due to this change in direction, there is a flow restrictions, and this liquid particles or gas particles are striking on that particular internal part of that pipe. And due to that, erosion may arises. So it is increase if the flow contains solid particles, because if the solid particles are present, obviously the striking rate is more and that may erode more metal particles, or by bubbles in liquids and by two-phase systems. So if the bubbles are present, so again, the turbulence is going to increase, and due to increase in turbulence or the velocity, that erosion rate may be increased. If the two-phase flows are there, again, the different flow systems and different liquids may have the different characteristics due to which erosion rate may be increased. Then wet steam flow, air jet flashing flow, pump cavitation can cause severe erosions. So these are the different fluid flow characteristics things in which the erosion may be observed. Then for this particular purpose, we can do the inspection. So that inspection may be a visual inspection, that may be a ultrasonic testing inspection, and we can use the other NDT testings for this corrosion monitoring. So visual inspection is the general or routine inspection which can be done by the supervisor or the expertise of that company or the organizations. Then we can use the one of the best ultrasonic testing from that NDT list for this particular corrosion. And if that ultrasonic testing is not feasible, then we can go for the radiographic testing, guided wave testing, or magnetic flux leakage testings. So these are the different testings available, and their different mechanisms can be studied. Then other than these testings, we can do the corrosion monitoring with the help of creating visual records to track the corrosion growth. So on the daily basis, on the particular shift wise basis, sometimes on the weekly, monthly basis, we have to maintain these records for the corrosion growth. Then monitoring ultrasonic thickness can be observed with the help of manual inspections or with the help of some lattice technology. Then using probes to measure the electrical resistance, that is one of the monitoring technique, and using coupon system. So a coupon is a piece of material that matches the material in the asset being monitored, and then that coupon acts as a proxy for the wall or the other area being monitored. So presenting a fairly simple way to monitor corrosion in almost in any scenario, to use this corrosion monitoring technique, you place the corrosion coupon, also known as mass loss coupon, into the asset for a predetermined amount of time, and then once removed, test it for the type of corrosion, rate of corrosion, and amount of corrosions. So these are the different monitoring techniques which are available for the corrosion. And very few techniques which are less common for this monitoring techniques are monitoring biological growth and monitoring hydrogen penetrations. So under this monitoring biological growth, the technique identifies the bacteria, as the wording is there, that is biological. So it is related to the bacteria within an acid that feed on sulfate. So these bacteria produce sulfuric acid, which is extremely corrosive. So their presence in an acid means that some amount of corrosion is highly likely. So it is related to the bacterial growth and their conversion to the sulfuric acid. Then hydrogen penetration. So using probes, you can measure the quantity of hydrogen that dissolved into steel. In oil and gas, hydrogen is often a byproduct of many of the reactions that takes place in oil and gas, and its presence can eventually result in the steel becoming brittle. So brittleness is one of the main issue due to these hydrogen penetrations. And then cracking, if left undetected and unmonitored. So brittle first, and if it is not observed and monitored, then it may convert into the cracking of that particular surface. So these are the different monitoring techniques. Now, how to prevent that corrosions? So to prevent that corrosion, there are various methods available. That may be a substitution of non-corrosive or less corrosive material tolerated by the process technology and economy, and the selection of such material from the design and erection stage avoids most of the corrosion problems. So replacement or substitution is one of the method. So less corrosive or non-corrosive material can be replaced. Then another prevention methods are rapid cleaning of spillage, good housekeeping, cathodic protection, control of flow, fluctuations and vibrations, water softening and removal of salts, checking of scale formation, on plates and tubes, descaling, dechoking, scrapping, timely repairing and preventive maintenance, and use of non-metallic material like plastic. So nowadays, most of the industries are adopting this last point, that is non-metallic material like plastic wherever it is applicable. And if the underground storage tanks or other vessels are there, then we can go for the cathodic protections. So these are the basic methods of the corrosion prevention. So this is the famous, that is cathodic protections. So it is a method of protecting metal structures from corrosion, commonly called rust, which is the degradation of metal material caused by reaction with its environment. So we are going to protect from the rusting of that metal part, rusting of that vessel, rusting of that tank. That is called as cathodic protections. So if the metal component of USD systems are not protected, they will eventually corrode and leak. So leakage may be the issue after the corrosion, and contamination of soil, groundwater and surface water by this petroleum and other hazardous substance may be the major issues after leaking due to this corrosion phenomena. And that is why we have to protect these underground tanks specially. And for that purpose, cathodic protection is the best options. So in this cathodic protection, there are two main types. One is sacrificial anode and second is impressed current cathodic protection. What exactly the sacrificial anode is? So from the name itself, it is clearly mentioned that there is a anode which is going to sacrifice. So for protecting the main pipeline or the main storage tanks, we have to sacrifice one of the anode. That is one of the electrodes. And for that purpose, we have to choose generally the magnesium or zinc anode. So from this diagram, you can understand that for this protection of the pipeline or the storage tanks, which is underground, we have to attach a sacrificial anode like magnesium or zinc, which is a high active metal as compared to this pipeline or tank. So this pipeline is of ferrous or iron, and magnesium or zinc is highly active metal as compared to Fe. And that is why this reaction of oxidation occurs, like Mg, that gives Mg2 plus and plus 2 electrons, where reduction is occur at the pipeline, that is O2 plus 4H plus plus 4 electrons, that gives twice of H2O. So rather than the oxidation on the pipeline or the tank, there is a reduction reaction. And at the sacrificial anode, due to the high active metal characteristics, oxidation occurs. And due to this oxidation, there is no chance of oxidation or the corrosion on this pipeline. So for this protecting the pipeline or these storage tanks, we have to sacrifice this anode intentionally. That is nothing but the magnesium or zinc. So this method is called as sacrificial anode. Then there is another method that is called as impressed current cathodic protection. So we have to produce a current which is more impressive than the natural way, and we have to protect that cathode part. So in this diagram, you can understand this, we have to protect this steel pipe, and we can understand the electron flow process, and this is the impressed current. So for that, creating this impressed current, we have to use the rectifier which converts the AC current into the DC. So that is the main mechanism in this impressed current cathodic protections. So this is DC power supply, and the rectifier is going to convert this AC to DC. And due to this AC to DC, this impressed current is passed, and then this anode becomes again the highly reactive one, and this steel pipe can be protected. So that is again, the steel pipe is nothing but the cathode. That is why this protection is called as cathodic protection with the help of impressed current. Then next concept is cladding. Generally, when we are talking about the cladding, then cladding is nothing but application of one material over another. So from this picture also you can understand there is a wooden part which is cladded on the walls. So the main purpose is to act as the insulations. So this overlayer or the second layer of wooden part is nothing but the thermal insulations. So which protect that building, which protect that infrastructure from the high temperature as well as from the low temperature. So that is the basic concept of cladding. So we can use this cladding concept for protecting the pipelines, storage tanks, pressure vessels, etc. With the help of cladding the different materials, which is non-corrosive. So cladding can be made of any of a wide range of including wood, metal, brick, vinyl and composite material that can include aluminium, wood, blends of cement and recycled polystyrene. So these are the different materials which can be used as a cladding material to protect the metals or the metallic structures from the corrosion. Then there is another option for protection of this corrosion is called as lining. So we can use this lining process from the internal part as well as from the external part, and the spraying of these different materials, that may be a glass, that may be a coating glass flakes, that may be organic epoxy coatings, that may be a PTFE coatings. So different lining can be used to protect this corrosion part. So from the internal or from the external point of view. So like glass lines, so glass line steel provides superior corrosion resistance to acids, alkalis, water and other chemical solutions. Then coating containing glass flakes have been used to improve both barrier properties and reinforcement in anti-corrosion coatings. Then organic epoxy coatings such as ceramic filled, modified epoxy non-volatile or high molecular weight polymer composites have been on the market for many years. Then PTFE coatings are commonly used in situations where superior corrosion resistances are required. So fluoropolymers are the material of choice for the process industry, serving as lining for vessels, piping, pumps, walls, columns, column internals, hoses, expansion joints, seals and gaskets. So we can utilize these different types and materials for the lining, that is depending on the condition. Thank you. Thank you very much.